Welcome to another edition of The Brand Called You. Today, I am very, very delighted to have a fellow storyteller with me. Nidhi Mahesh, welcome to the show.
Hello, Ashutosh. Nice speaking to you.
Thank you. Nidhi is the chief storyteller of We Storytellers. She has worked for Times Now, Sahara TV, ETV, and Doordarshan. And she's associated with Seven Lakes Technologies, Manthan, MindTech, and MindTree. So Nidhi, tell me a little bit about your early career.
Thanks, Ashutosh. So I started my career pretty early. I was in school actually in grade 12 when I started working, not of course professionally, but yeah, I started taking on assignments, doing interviews, publishing them on local newspapers, working for as a freelancer for All India Radio, Doordarshan. That's how I got into journalism. So it wasn't a planned choice. It just happened to be that it's a drift and you got in there. So right. When I got into journalism, that's a time which was very new to India. We were opening up to the private news, so to say. Transition from Doordarshan to private news was just happening. I'm talking about 96, 97. And we were like the first breed of journalists who were broadcast natives. You know, we were born in television era. So we don't come from a print background and then making it here. So we were learning the ropes right there. And one interesting thing that happened at that time, at the start of our career, is that we didn't have a template to follow, right? So this was completely new medium, a new language being created in media, and we were just expected to go with the flow and learn every day. And those were very fascinating times, because I started my career with ETV, that's Inadu. Most people didn't even know what ETV stood for, because we were not seen in the place that we were working in. It was an Andhra-based channel, very popular in Andhra Pradesh, but not known in the... I come from Calcutta. I was working in the Bureau of Calcutta. And interestingly, we would do our stories in English. It will come to the desk here and they will just translate and put it up there. So that's how I started my career in television, right from the beginning, learning the language as we grew. And the medium changed so rapidly. Initially, we would have those high band cameras. Can you imagine today, three people holding cameras, one camera, one person holding a recorder and one person holding a microphone, and then a light man, and it's like a whole clan going out for a shoot. So that used to be the time, and we used to have those huge cassettes that we will carry and run to the airport. Somehow we had to get the news out. Those were very different, all typical manual labor, if you want to call it. That's how the news started. And then new technology keep coming in. And as journalists, we were not just supposed to report. We were also supposed to, grow with the medium, understand the medium, and master it. So there weren't those typical training sessions where you're told. It's just that you're thrust into a situation, now deal with it. Right. So that's how the grounding has been. So those were my early days. Right. And then I moved to marketing, and from there to here.
Yeah, so I can understand what you're saying, because I'm much older than you are. But when I was in college in the mid-70s, I used to do programs on All India Radio. And I used to earn 20 rupees per program, the Forces Request and, these music programs. And then I can understand what you're talking about. Of course, it's in a different generation altogether. But what would you say, Nidhi, are three key milestones in your life or your career?
When you talk about milestones, well, I've never seen them as milestones, but when I look back, I see those turning points. So one, of course, was the news, like the way I got into news. I'm not trained news person. I'm not from a mass comm background. I'm a political, political science was my subject. But I got in there because that's how things were. So news was one of my milestones. And learning that news, like news is, I think people say people should spend 1 year in army to learn the life, how life is lived. I think people just should spend at least a year in journalism to see different facets of life. You see the best of it, you see the worst of it. So that's one milestone. But one interesting milestone that happened, it was in 2004. I worked on a film. It was a Of the Children, For the Children, and By the Children film. It was first of its kind in India. I was a creative director for it. The the interesting part is not that we made the film and it got the best film award in Athens, but it became a turning point for those kids that we made the film with. They were 11 kids of a orphanage. And after we left them with that, I know that they carried on with that. And every year they made films and they kind of learned the medium and they got the support from the government, from the leading directors of that time. So that's a turning point in the sense that it made a difference to my, that's where the storytelling came in. Though I, in without knowing, without consciously being aware, I created a band of storytellers. And then the next milestone was when I moved to a completely uncharted road through marketing. And I learned from the best of the masters, again, not having any training in marketing. But if you would know Subrata Bhakti of Mindtree, he's the mentor. He brought me from journalism to marketing. I was a journalist working in Bangalore at that time, interviewing him. And just things just happened and I got into marketing. And because I could write, I could understand the content. That's why I could make this transition. And the very recent milestone is We Storytellers.
Well, I'll just come to now We Storytellers. Tell me about the venture and what are you doing? I mean, you're creating storytellers.
Not exactly creating storytellers, but creating stories that matter. So this again, We Storytellers is not something, it's a very calculated or a thought through move. This is a kind of a natural progression. I've been telling stories in different genres. I started with news, moved to marketing, and I kept on writing. I've been a ghostwriter for a long time, so most people don't, ghosts don't exist, but you know, I can bust that myth because I'm a ghost. So what I realized is that the way the marketing language is evolving, the way the companies are telling their stories, there's a disconnect. There's a too much of selling going on. There's a deluge of content. You are trying your hands at everything, and somewhere the connect is getting lost. And that I'm a firm believer that a communication, if it is done with right intent and with the right thought behind it, you'll definitely be able to connect. So that was the persuasion for me to start exploring and building an organization where we focus on storytelling. And when I began sometime in May this year, that was like as recent as that time, formally, of course, we were doing it in different forms before that. In the couple of months, we realized that, okay, we are talking about stories that marketers will tell to the customer. But what about stories that need to be told internally? Because what happens is there's a disconnect in what you are saying to the external world and what you're telling your employees inside. And what and then there's a, it's a different story. You know, people don't speak the same language. And that's when you have to train people up when they're going in front of the customer or they're meeting. So your voice should be inside out. You speak the same language outside that you speak inside. And that's where we found that organization communication is a very important aspect. And that then we built that into our offering. And then we found that there are a lot of leaders who have very solid background. They have experiences, expertise, but they're not able to articulate it out, right? So there's an opportunity to support them in becoming a thought leader. So that's, again, an offering.
So without giving names, can you give me an example?
I'll give you an example of a recent leader we engaged with. So the leader comes with a strong background in security, you know, managing private data and stuff. But then what happens is, and despite having a lot of patents, despite having all the work that they have been doing behind the scene, when it comes to executive presence, it's something that you lose out to people who don't really have that much of depth, but they have an executive presence. So we kind of the leader in building a voice and creating, and here we don't follow a template. I'm not a very great fan of a template or a framework because every person is unique and their voice is unique. And as storytellers, my role is not to tell you this is how you should speak. I have no locus standi saying that. But what I do is that if this is what you say, if this is what your personality is, your thoughts should come out in that manner. So your voice is something. So we say that we amplify your voice. I don't create your voice. it's your voice at the end of the day. It's just that you're taking it out. So that's the kind of support we did. And we're seeing the person very flourishing at this moment.
So tell me, what is the, you know, you've been in news and you said in political news, and now you're also doing business storytelling. What, in your opinion, is the difference between news storytelling and business storytelling?
Before I answer that, I must tell you, Ashutosh, I can't recognize the news that I see today. It's completely different from the time I left.
Journalism has changed completely now. So
it's completely changed, and I cringe to call it news, but yeah, that's a different discussion.
Understand.
So in a traditional way, or in the way a news should be, news is about information. As a reporter, I'm passionate about reporting, but I'm not passionate about a report. Right? There's a distinction.
Correct.
I have to be completely dispassionate about the subject I'm reporting. I'm supposed to gather information, gain as many perspectives as I can, and relate to my customer, my audience. It is for them to take a decision, and it's aimed for. So that's a basic distinction between news stories and business stories, is that news stories is only to inform you, while the business stories are about nudging you, making you take a decision, right? That's what all marketers do. We try to tell a story in a way that connects to you, and that takes you to the next step in the journey, as we call the customer journey. So that's the basic difference. It's information. Here, the information is designed in a way that it kind of goes into the next step.
So my next questions are based on your own experience. What makes a good writer?
For me, a good writer is someone who has clarity of what we are saying. It's very simple. We need to know what we are trying to say. And we have to have a structure. The way you are trying to tell a story, there has to be a structure. Again, I don't say that it has to be a structure like this or that, but every story has to be told in a flow, in a structure. So clarity, structure, and flow. These are the three things.
Let me understand what you mean by structure of a story.
Where are we beginning? What is it that we want to convey? That clarity when we have, then we know that where should we begin? How do we carry the story forward? And how do we keep the audience engaged with me till the last word? Right? That is what a structure is about. You build it in a way that it flows. It's not something which is like, I want to add this here. So there's a problem of plenty. We want to say a lot of things, right? But how do I fit that in into a flow? Structure it out. That's where the structure comes in.
Interesting. Very interesting. And following question to you is that what makes a good story? I mean, I've often spoken to many people, and there's that old line that every person has a book inside them. And I've often told people that everyone's life is a great story.
Yes.
Right? What are your thoughts? Because a lot of people say, no, I have nothing to speak.
For me, a story is something I can relate to. That's as simple as that. So most of the time when you read a book, you become one of the characters. You start thinking that this is me, or you start thinking, well, how would I do this? Because the story at somewhere is relating to you, is appealing to you. And that relatability in a story, I think, is very, very important. Because everyone reads something with a very different perspective. So a story is a conversation which is between one to one. I'm in a private dialogue with the author. Or I'm going with in the journey with the author with my own perspective. Unless I'm able to relate to it, you may like a book, right? There are a lot of great writers and great books. Some people love them, and some people can't even stand 10 pages. That's because I'm not able to relate to the story. It's not about a good or bad story. It's about relatability. So for me, the relatability is very important.
So one more question on storytelling before I move to the next part of the show. This is the age of the millennials and the Gen Zs. How many of the millennials are really reading books, or are they more focused on visual and audio medium?
There's two ways to answer this question. One is to refer to statistics and numbers that any website will throw at you.
Absolutely.
Another is to look at how YC around me. So look at the number of literature festivals that are happening, and look at the crowd there. What is the age group? right? There, so we, I can't say that millennials and Gen Zs are not reading. I have a 10-year-old son and he's a voracious reader. And so, but what happens is the medium has changed. People, and it also depends on the convenience and in the state of mind you are in, where you are. People are reading on Kindle. People are consuming stories on Audible because they are, when they are traveling, it's there. And yeah, so maybe the medium may have differed, but I can't say that they are not reading. Of course, they are reading, and I think they are much more involved. They look at different forums on social media and see how they dissect each book. There are a lot of book clubs that I'm part of, and the depth of discussion is very, very good. So even if not everyone reading, whoever is reading with their soul into it. And then that's important. And being a storyteller, you know, I depend on audience, right? So I believe that they are listening.
No, I agree with you. I mean, you know, I used to read extensively, you know, and a lot. And yet now I have almost, you know, I would say more than 60-65% of my stories, I'm now listening to an Audible or other such media because I find it more convenient.
Yes.
So, yeah, you're absolutely right. So, Nidhi, I'm going to move to a few questions for you personally. My first question to you is, where do you draw your inspiration from?
From everyday happening. Mm-hmm. I get inspired looking at my son playing. I get inspired when I see a flower blooming. I get inspired when I walk down the road and see someone, you know, just doing his daily core and selling something with all his heart into it. I find that, I must tell you this interesting thing. I'm not sure whether you've been to Calcutta, but
Calcutta
has a strong sense of street food, right? But if you look beyond the street food, you see a brand there, you know, a brand language. You would find people selling a particular kind of food in a different attire, with a different tone. Right. And you will be able to distinguish between them. So you see them from afar and you see and you will know what that person is going to sell at what price point and where. Now, this is something for a big brand. They take years and, you know, tons of money and a lot of strategy to get there. These guys have perfected it. Right. So there are lessons when you look at them. So they're a walking example of how a brand is built, because and the brand affinity. The moment I see that guy, I know what he's going to offer. Mm-hmm. And these are very, very small things. But, you know, these are the images that you stay with you, and they are a story in themselves. So those are inspirations. So for me, I can't say that that one person inspires me or one thought inspires me. I get inspired by anything that I see around.
So my next question to you is that if you, Nidhi, were a role model to millions of children who closely followed your life choices, what is the one thing you would change in yourself?
I think there are a lot of issues, there are a lot of places where I thought that I should stand up and raise my voice. Mm-hmm. There were circumstances, there were some insecurities, there were many things that stopped me from doing that. And another thing is that being a political being has somehow become a no-no. But I think it's important. It's important that a child is political in the sense that understands at what context he or she is living. What is the role that he has to play in building a polity? So, I have a political thought. I've never expressed it. Right. So I would want the children to grow up to be political beings. And this is controversial because people will say, why do you say that? It's important because you're part of a democracy and it's a participative democracy. Yes. If you're non-political, then you're not in. Right. This can't be a second-hand democracy.
Correct.
That's one thing I would want to change.
Well said. Next question is, what is the most exciting and challenging aspect of your new work in storytelling?
Oh, every moment is challenging and every moment is exciting. We learn every day new things. We come across a facet we had not seen before. So, and a story unfolds in different ways every day. So that's, there's nothing more exciting than this. And so, and story is all we are about. We are human beings and we are like built and fed on story. So that's the most exciting part.
What does success mean to you?
Success means happiness.
Okay.
you start a day with a smile and say, okay, this is a good day. I'm looking forward to it. That's success.
Okay.
It's not a crown on your head.
Okay. Very interesting. Next question is that if you could gain one ability or quality you admired in someone else, what would it be?
Is the ability to do whatever you want to without really thinking of consequences. You are a mother, you cannot do that. You are a professional, you cannot do that. You are a woman, you cannot do that. But there are a lot of constraints we put around it, and there are people who are rising above that and doing what they actually believe in. I won't say I'm a hypocrite, but somewhere, there's a lot of mental barriers that you create around yourself. So I would like to rise above that someday and say what I feel like saying without fearing that I might be in jail next day.
So I have now time for two more questions. The next question is that how do you set personal and professional goals?
Honestly speaking, I haven't been very structured or disciplined on that line. Things have happened and you kind of went along with the flow. And so I didn't really say that this is what I want to be in 5 years' time or this is where I want to be in 10 years' time. But today, after I took on the role of an entrepreneur and now I have not just my career to think of, but my colleagues and my teams, and I am responsible for delivering not only for my clients and customers, but also for my team and giving them a career path. So I think now I must need very specific goals and vision and that's at an organization level. So for us as a storytellers, our goal is to expand and not only in terms of clientele, but also in terms of storytelling as a discipline that we can take forward. So that's the goal that we have.
Okay, wonderful. And my last question to you, come back to the pandemic that the whole world is facing. How are you rethinking your life and your work in the new world order?
In terms of life, what the pandemic has shown us is that to live and to live happily, we don't really need too many things. Yeah, you can do with very little and be happy. We add a lot of frills around it and we start thinking that, oh, this is something we need. In the past 6 months, when you're not able to go out, when you're not able to socialize, when you're not able to do a lot many things that you would otherwise do, you realize that those weren't really something that, that were part of your being anyway. They were good to have. You can do without them. So you understand the necessity and the core of life to things that are not really that important. So that distinction that has come in. And in terms of my work, well, there's no better way to tell stories. These are the stories I think will tell to our generations to come. I hope they don't have stories like this of their own. So they listen to the grandma stories that we would be telling them. And this is a life-altering experience that all of us are going through. Right. So I'm professionally and as a storyteller, I think this is the best time to weave stories.
Yes. Nidhi, thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure speaking to you. I wish we storytellers lots of success.
Thank you, Ashut. It was a pleasure speaking to you as well.
Thank you for listening to The Brand Called You videocast and podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience, and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website, www.tbcy.in, to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for The Brand Called You.